Welcome back. In the previous lecture, we concluded that a standard, if well designed, can increase infrastructure flexibility. In this video, we will first look in more detail into standards characteristics that increase infrastructure flexibility. Next, we will zoom out again, summarize the key issues addressed in these two videos, and round off by discussing whether standards can also catalyze more radical infrastructure transitions. In the previous systemic approach, we treated standards as a black box, as if it doesn't matter what a standard is like to understand how it affects an infrastructure. It's time to look a little closer and ask ourselves whether standards with certain characteristics are better in creating flexibility than others. I'm going to discuss three very different characteristics. The degree of consensus the standards reflects, its specificity, and its simplicity. Regarding consensus, we saw in the previous lecture that standardization of container dimensions was just as much an issue of bridging social incompatibilities between subsystems as technical incompatibilities. The better the standard succeeds in doing both, the happier the committee members and the stronger their willingness to support the standard. Regarding the specificity, some standards are very detailed. Especially for people new to a field, this often makes it easier to implement them. But they sometimes include requirements that are not strictly necessary. These detailed standards are called descriptive standards, and sometimes product specifications. For example, in the ISO Committee for Container Standardization, some people proposed to also specify the material containers should be made of. For example, aluminium. However, had this proposal been accepted, it would have unnecessarily hampered container manufacturers in countries where aluminium was expensive to produce. In general, only specifying the required performance of a product or service leaves much more room to innovate. With such performance standards, no restrictions are set on how the performance is to be achieved. This radically increases the possibility for system change. I don't have the room here to discuss our research on the Vobbe Index standard for natural gas, but I can highly recommend it for those who want to pursue this subject. As for the simplicity of a standard, I spoke earlier of the political nature of most standards processes. Typically, there's a lot of pressure on standards committees to include additional solutions in the standard. Sometimes the only way to get results seems to be to accept an ugly compromise. For example, the committee may leave wordings ambiguous so that the standard can be interpreted in different ways. Or the committee may agree to the inclusion of extra options. Standards users can then choose the option that serves them best and still claim compliance to the standard. On the face of it, you might think that extra options will increase system flexibility because it allows for more diversity. But in practice, standards options lead to interoperability problems. That is, to products that are standard compliant but incompatible. straightforward and simple standards, like the initial proposal for the Series 1 ISO container, contribute much more strongly to system flexibility. Concerning the container, perhaps interesting to know, in the second draft of the container standard, extra lengths were added. See the picture. Next to extra options within one standard, also extra standards can be developed. This option too was initially considered by the ISO Committee for Container Standardization. Apart from the Series 1, the maritime container I've been talking about, a Series 2 and 3 standard was discussed. Standards that would better match the status quo of the railways in Europe and in the USSR, respectively. These proposals never became full ISO standards. But had they succeeded, the same kind of interoperability problems would have arisen as with standards with multiple options. To summarize, we've been looking at how compatibility standards create room for infrastructure change. The thing is to design them to be as generic as possible. Generic as possible in the way they connect complementary and substitutive subsystems. This is done by specifying performance standards, as little detail as possible, and keeping the standard simple, where possible, no options. The more consensus, the better the socio-technical compatibility, the more likely the standard will be widely implemented, and the stronger its impact as a generic gateway. A standard's potential to allow more radical change resides, first of all, in the exchangeability of subsystems. This creates flexibility, not only in the system at hand, but also makes subsystems reusable in future infrastructures. Second, the loose connection created by generic gateways creates room for subsystems to evolve. This is illustrated in the figure. Subsystem 4 of infrastructure A has evolved into subsystem 4 apostrophe and become part of the new infrastructure B. We've studied several cases to explore to what degree standards allow more radical infrastructure change. These include a case in which we explored the possibility to shift from a natural gas-based to a hydrogen economy, and a study of the shift from barcode to RFID-based baggage handling in airports. For more information, see the suggested reading material. To round off, I've mostly been talking about infrastructures that are large technical systems, LTSs. But in the previous Next Generation Infrastructures course, I also spoke of inverse infrastructures, user-driven, self-organizing, bottom-up infrastructures, a phenomenon which is becoming increasingly influential. What role do compatibility standards play in these infrastructures? Now let's take the example of the smart grid, around which much development activity is taking place. I quote here the aim of the ADREM project. The smart grid is to support a situation in which consumers and producers of energy can automatically find each other. The parties concerned can be families as well as communities with solar panels on their roof. If one can automatically sell one's energy surplus to others locally, people's dependency on the national grid and large energy producers will diminish. In this scenario, intelligent software standards play a key role. Interoperability is crucial at all levels. It is crucial for the exchange of information between inverse producers and consumers of, for example, solar, wind, and biomass energy, but also to interconnect the growing number of subsystems. The smart grid standards can be seen as multi-sided platforms. The more different kind of producers connect, the more consumers benefit, and vice versa. These standards need to be open and vendor independent, make it easy to connect new subsystems to the smart grid, and define how to interoperate without hindering the simultaneous evolution of different subsystems. Or, in the terms used previously, standards are needed that will bridge socio-technical differences, are performance-oriented, and simple as possible. The better these requirements are met, the smoother and more radical the energy infrastructure transition. In these two lectures, we have seen that standards can increase infrastructure flexibility, the flexibility of LTSs as well as inverse infrastructures. For those of you who want to know more, I've included some references on the website. Thank you for your attention.